scientific interpretation of Hinduism. I think in the Nyaya Vaisheshik system there are two categories. One is Samanya, universal property, another is particular property. So, Hindutva means a universal property that resides in all knowledge of non-dual reality. So, form-wise we all are different from each other, but essence-wise we are the same. So, if we realize that essence residing everywhere, then this is the state of knowledge. So we believe in this absolute knowledge, not in approximate knowledge. Approximate knowledge represents ignorance. Then we also believe that male and female are not separate from each other. They are the manifestation of same truth. As the first chapter of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, sa ekaki naivrayame dvidha apatya, paticca patinicca. So, pati and patni, or male and female, are not subordinate to each other. They are the manifestation of same truth. And a very nice example has been given there. It has been compared to a seed of dal, earth prigalami. So, in a seed of pulse, there are two aspects within, but they belong to the same unit. So, this kind of understanding is of Hindutva. We believe in this kind of manifestation, and finally we are nature centric. So we are worshipper of nature. Prime Minister rightly pointed out in Paris that India has been the worshipper of nature. So in modern science there are two world views they are finding on the basis of experiment, that if you are nature worshipper, if you think that nature is your extension, then you can protect nature as you protect yourself without making any effort. So in this way, Prime Minister told that India has been protecting nature, so we are nature-centric, we are nature worshipper. So these properties actually construct Hinduism. So this is totally different from Semitic worldview, where they believe in domination. This way there are so many things we totally differentiate from them. In this way, if we use this term Hindutva, that actually represents Sanatana Dharma. So this is the background. I think he has pointed out everything very nicely in his book. But I also want to make certain comments on the content of the book. And the first is that there may be a factual error that the ashram of Swami, the guru of Adi Shankaracharya, Govindpad, was not at Badrinath. It was in Omkarishwar, and there is a cave there. I think that should be corrected. Other thing, and Shankar was not in this guise of Buddhism. Shankar was propagating Upanishadic philosophy. And it should also be known properly that Upanishad is not different from Ved. Actually, Upanishad is Ved itself. There are two parts of Ved. One is action-oriented, other is knowledge-oriented. So, same Sanghita, same Brahman can be treated as action-oriented part, and other is knowledge-oriented part. For example, the Vajasnayi Sanghita is of Yajurveda. So the 39 chapters of Vajasnayi Sanghita is action-oriented, that is Karma Kanda. And the 48th chapter of the same Vajasnayi Sanghita is Isavasya Upanishad. So similarly, Keno Upanishad. Keno Upanishad is the 9th chapter of Tavalkar Sakha of Samveda. Munduko Upanishad is the direct part of Atharved Sanghita. So in this way, I think there is a since we do not go through our original text, so there are so many problems. So once you start talking, you find everywhere problems. So generally, Upanishad is different from Ved. This is that. I think this should be corrected properly. Second point, that Brahminical, the use of Brahminical word is very much obvious. Actually, leftist scholars use this term. It was coined by Britishers, British has to again create problem in Indian society. You know, Vedic tradition is the alone tradition which accommodate all sections of society. So you can find 27 female Rishika there. 27 female Rishika, and Brihadevta gives you the list. So Kapala, Ghosha, so many 20, this is the single religion, you can say the foundational text of Hinduism, which has been developed by 27 female Rishikas. Then Vishwamitra was not a Brahmin. Vishwamitra was belonging to some other varn. Then Mahidhar Atre was belonging to what you say now, the SC category. Satyakam Javali, he was not a Brahmin. And Adi Shankaracharya quotes so many times Javal Upanishad and Atre Upanishad. Again, Vyas was not a Brahmin. Vyas was from other section. So he actually, I suggested Rajesh ji to extend it further, to write a contribution of Vyas to Hinduism. So this is very, very needed. And Vyas actually wrote Brahma Sutra on Upanishad. Actually, this is the logical presentation of Vedic thought. Then Vyas ji wrote Bhagavad Gita, Mahabharata, then Puranas. So Valmiki wrote Ramayana, he was not Brahmin. So if you think, and later on if you move to Bhakti Andolan, then there are so many jnani there, realized person, who belong to different sections of the society. So in this connection, I can also say that Bhakti Andolan is the manifestation of Vedantic worldview, Vedantic philosophy. For example, Surdas was the disciple of Vallabhacharya. Ravidas and Kabir Das was the disciple of Ramananda Acharya. Ramananda Acharya wrote Ananda Bhashya on Brahma Sutra. Vallabh wrote Anu Bhashya on Brahma Sutra. And Mirabai was the disciple of Ravidas. So Kabir Das, my student is there, he has done a research on Adi Shankaracharya and Kabir. So you, if you go through original text, you will find that Kabir Das is nothing but the extension of Adi Shankaracharya. The whole philosophy is there. Again, you rightly pointed out about Tulsi Das. Tulsi Das, in the beginning of Ramchritamanas, says, Yan maya vasvarti vishu matilam brahmadi devasura, yat sattvadam rishayv bhati sakalam rajyo yatha her brahma, yat padam plavamek melhi bhavam bodhesthiti savatam, Vande ham tamase sakaran param ramakya visan. So he is just presenting Shankar's philosophy there. He has rightly pointed out everything. And he is also saying that what I have taken Ram as the hero of this text, that has been accepted as Ram by people. Tamase sakaran param ramakya ka matlab jisko log Ram kehte hain. Ram ki baat yahan kar rahe hain. So I think the whole Bhakti Andolan, Kabir, Guru Nanak Dev, Japuji Sahab is nothing but the Upanishadic philosophy. So whole Vedantic theory, Bhakti Andolan is the manifestation of Vedic worldview. But as you pointed out that the Guru of Pranambar Singh Ji, Hajari Prasad Dwivedi Ji, Hajari Prasad Dwivedi Ji gave a turn, new turn. And on the basis of that philosophy, Nambar Singh started something writing different, and he wrote a book, Nai Parampara Ki Khoj. Nai Parampara Ki Khoj means he is looking at something new from Vedic perspective, from Vedic philosophy, and he is giving a twist that Shankar is a rebellion, Kabir is a rebellion. He is not in the tune of Vedic philosophy. So we have started so many research work on this issue, and that is totally baseless understanding. Other thing that you have very rightly said that Shankar found a thing that unites everything, and actually he chose consciousness. Atma, Brahma, from Upanishad or Ved, that of Adi Shankaracharya was commented very soon by Vachaspati Mishra from Uttar Bihar. And you can find manuscript of Vachaspati Mishra's Bhamati at Saraswati Mahal Library, Tanjore. So you can find the same manuscript in Kashmir. So this kind of linguistic extension was given there, and this is also a unifying thing. So I think that was left there. I will also, if you allow me 5 to 10 minutes. Bhakti and Bhagavan. This is also, these two terms have been used in your book. So, bhakti is not something new that came from thought. This should be clearly understood. Bhakti, we have three Vedatrayi. Vedatrayi means one in poetic form, other is in prose form, and the third one is in the mixture, prose plus poetry. This is Vedatrayi. Generally, it is not. General Acharya Shankar has also used in the Kenopanishad Bhashya. So, this has been finally, Samved is representing bhakti tradition. And that has been finally concluded in Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says, Chatur Vidha Bhajante Mam Jana Sukriti Norjano Aiko Jigya Surarthati Jnani Chabhartasava. There are four types of bhakti. Artharthi for wealth, Arth for eradicating pain, and for Jigyasu, to know something, to know reality. And finally, Jnani Bhakti. Krishna says in the next slok that Jnani is myself. Jnani Tvatma Yume Mata. So, and finally in the last part of 18th chapter, he says, Sarva Dharman Paritya Jyomame Kam Saranam Vrajo Aham Tva Sarva Pape Vyo Mokshi Syami Masucha. So, finally he give importance to Bhakti. So, Bhagavad Gita is the also text of Bhakti. And that was extended by Adi Shankaracharya. You know, Adi Shankaracharya has written poetry on all forms of natural deities. Narmadashtakam, Gangashtakam, Yamunashtakam, Ram, Vishnu, Ganesh, Surya, Pagambulin, Dinmin, Divyasam, Pradayakam, Kalomalo, Bharahari, Sarvatirtha, Nayakam, Sumachya, Kachya, Nakra, Chakra, Chakravak, Sarmadetva, Diyapad, Pankajam, Namami, Devinamoy. This is Narmadashtakam. So if you go through, you will find actually he is the propagator of bhakti. And it's sure that Brahmanacharya also played very important role. And bhakti is the tool through which we spread our thought. To mass, because that attracts mass. So you can, I always say, you can say is equal to mc squared in a pinpointed way. But the same thought can be popularized through Puranic method. So actually this is, bhakti plays this kind of role. So this is the one aspect, and Bhagavan is totally different from bhakti. Bhagavan word has been used there. Bhagavan means bhag. Bhag is aishwaryasya samagrasya dharmasiyasya sakri sriya jnan vairagya masyato sanna bhag itirna. This is the definition of bhag. If you possess six things all together, then you are Bhagavan. So anyone can, so Rajneesh used to say, I am Bhagavan. So anyone can claim I am Bhagavan if you possess six things. Aishwarya samagrasya, Aishwarya, Dharma, Yasa, Sri Lakshmi, Gyan and Vairagya. Chhe cheez, kisi ke paas bhi ho, to Bharatiya Vaidik Parampara mein wo keh sakta hai tumhe Bhagavan. Isliye Bhagavan has nothing to do with Bhagavan. One thing. And personal versus impersonal. This is also very important thing. You know, Acharya Shankar moved from personal to impersonal. You rightly pointed out, Vivekananda also used to say so many times, we move from Dvait to Visishtadvait, from Visishtadvait to Advait. This is the final goal of human being. One or two points more. I suggested Rajesh ji that you just continue it and write a book on Vyasa. And if possible, on Yagyavalkya too. Because Yagyavalk is also a very big personality in Hindu tradition. You know, in the 6th chapter of Chandogya Upanishad, when Shvetaketu came back from Gurukul and he started talking like a JNU student, Great India, Phalana India, so he also started talking that who is Yagyavalk, I will challenge, I will this, that, I know much. So Aruni Udalak got worried that is this kind of development we need in our students or son? Then he started saying that, do you know what is the essence of this universe? No, nobody has taught me. No, there is something. Then he gives example of gold, soil, that if you know the gold, then your mind is based on singularity. If you know the forms of the gold, then your mind captures plurality. So it is up to you whether you are form-oriented or essence-oriented. So essence is the ultimate thing that should be realized properly. And then this Mahavakya comes, Tattvamasi. You are not this body, mind, amalgamation of body, mind, and intellect and other things. You are the essence, that is consciousness, that is Atma. And if you realize this, then Yagyavalk will not be your opponent, Yagyavalk are you. So in this way, this kind of understanding we want in our citizen. So this is the contribution of Yagyavalk. So Yagyavalk is a very towering person at that time. And finally, one thing that generally myth and belief, this is also terms coined by Britishers. So our system is not a myth. Our system is not a belief system. Our system is based on the realization of truth. So te dhyan yogam gata apashyan devatma shaktim sogunair nigudham. So from Nasadi Sukta to Shweta Sutta Upanishad, Rishi means who realized truth. That has been accepted as Rishi.